بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. إن شاء الله our subject today is going to be about what happened exactly to سيدة الزهراء عليها السلام before her death, 6 months before her death. All the stories that Shia claim, are they true? And some their new Shias now they're saying what happened was fake. Even from Sayyid Muhammad Hussain Fadallah, many people they always refer to him since he presented new studies about his questioning actually what happened to Sayyid Zahra, is it true or not? Because we always know and we always been suffering every time we hear about Sayyid Zahra, those people claim to they hit the door, they broke the door. The door went inside her rib. Her rib was broken, and there's a son called Mohsen. They killed Mohsen basically, and because of this incident, Sayyida Zahra later, she was murdered. Is that true or not? Now, if we go to all the Shia books, we have referred before. We talked before many times that Shia been under attack for 1400 years. If some people now they say we are, alhamdulillah, we are doing much better now as community altogether, we are helping each other out. But now after ISIS came, it revived all the past. Shia only been like this now in power only maybe for 40 years or 30 years if you really read the history. Before, any place they find Shia, they immediately kill them. We spent our all history running from place to place, either running or even fighting, running or fighting. So some, I will keep saying some of our brothers Sunnis, they come to us and they say, why you always open the past? Why you always say that you live in the past? We should live in the future. But actually we don't live in the past. We are the only people now, if you look in a political map for the Middle East, you find us where we should be. We are the only people. All others are only following the, even by their names, they call them as-salaf, you know, as-salaf, salafiyin, the people who follow the past, the sahaba or something, they call them as-salaf. Even by their name, they're claiming that they're following that, so and so. But us, we kept our pain intact, especially for what happened to Imam al-Hussein. He is the only reason why we stay alive, Imam Hussein. That's why we always commemorate this incident, Ashura, or what happened. Same thing for our Imams. Even though each Imam was able to do a big revolution, but back then, because there was many, many people attacking Shia, because they want to save us, they didn't want to do the same revolution that Imam Hussein did. Because the dream is, who is Imam Mahdi? Because Imam Mahdi now, he prepared many people to do this act, this job, because we are in a place now, we are able to do so. There's many, alhamdulillah, there's many knowledgeable people from the Shia, from Ahlul Bayt, even from the Sunnis, that they know the truth. There are many Sunnis now, even if they don't agree 100% with Shia, but they say those people, they're right. You know, they always use the Quran, they always use the best example for Rasulullah. Because I was reading, there's many articles for Sunni thinkers. They say Islamic Sunni, the Sunni Islam, as political way, it failed completely. Because what's happening now, it's very, what's happening for example, ISIS or Jabhat al-Nusra in Sham or in Damascus or Syria, and there's like more than 70 or 80 or 100. Even in Palestine, some of them, they're representing Islam in a bad way. Only people representing Islam in a good way are Shia now. And we have many evidence. We're not saying this because we are Shia. But all this referred to someone taught us everything, but this person, nobody really knew about him. Now we're gonna talk more deeper about who is this person who taught Imam Hussein how to be like this. Okay, it's gonna be a little surprising, but even though Imam Hussein is an imam, but there's someone who taught him how to be like this, right? Okay. We go back in history. After the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, even during his death, something happened, and many people, they always read it, but they pass, you know, they say, okay, this is what happened because so and so. I'm gonna mention what is it exactly. During his death, while he was dying that time, and this is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari, he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet Muhammad, he said, give me pen and paper, so I will write you something you will never be like, yeah, you will never lose the way. There's a person inside that is inside that room. He said, no, don't give him that because he is innahu yahjur, yani he's becoming delusionist, yani he's imagining many things. If we're gonna study the psychology of what he said exactly, many Shia refer to that as that person is Umar, you know that. It's been classics now, everybody, even Sunnis, they know about it. Because it is in Sahih al-Bukhari. I'm not mentioning this story from Al-Kafi or something. Even us, when we talk about Al-Kafi, there are some narrations inside Al-Kafi, we put next to them big question marks because we don't have anything that called Sahih. Sahih mean right, 100% right. Even inside the Kafi, the person who wrote the Kafi, he said in one the paper, if you read it, please, I did my best to bring all the Shia narration from Ahlul Bayt. The people gonna come after me, please try your best to take the best from that and correct it. And he didn't, because he didn't have much time. He spent all his life collecting ahadith, but there he said that many of these ahadith are fake. People put this ahadith fake because he couldn't see the legitimacy of this hadith. So he asked the people after to come to clean this after. Anyway, so in that point, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa sallam, he want pen and paper. And Umar, he said, no, you cannot have pen and paper because he is getting like a little crazy and we cannot really trust what he's gonna write. Okay. Now we have a question. Many Shia, they said because he doesn't want him to write something about Imam Ali. But we ask here, there's something very important. Imam Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned Imam Ali in many times that you should go do bay'ah for Imam Ali, and they did in Hujjat al-Wada'. He stood in a podium, you know, they put like big podium there. It was very hot. Even in that place, subhanAllah, Allah Azza wa Jal, he created it in a way, and people visit that place now where Imam Ali and Rasulullah stood. If you speak, the voice will be so loud. Yani the way Allah Azza wa Jal, he created that area, any voice will pass by, it will create big echo. You know, we'll be able to do that now. I mean, you go some places, you speak, the voice will be very intact, right, inside the room. You'll be able to design something that the voice will be echoed. This way, the same place, in Ghadir Khum, this place called Ghadir Khum, it's like a valley of Khum, it's in Saudi Arabia. It is a point between Medina and Mecca, and inshallah, if you go there, you can visit it, and you can check what I'm saying. So in that place, Imam Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he took the hand of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib and he said, "Man kuntu mawla fa Ali mawla." Yani, who I am the mawla of? Ali is his mawla too. Yani, I am. If you consider me, I am your master. Is Ali is your master too? Allahumma wali man wala wa adi man ada wa ansur man nasar wa khdal man khadal. Yani, he was basically saying, this is your imam. Follow him after. If you care about me, follow that guy after me. Many now narration from the Sunnis, they say it is, they mention this narration from 12,000 hadith in their books, 12,000 hadith. But how they destroyed the meaning of it, they said he went there just to claim he loved Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is how they claim. It's very weak the way they're presenting, and they will give you a few ayah from the Quran claiming this is what's happening. But we can later talk, reflect more about this subject. Anyway, we'll continue because it's important. All this important, what happened exactly to Sayyidah Zahra. To see later, is what happened real or was fake? Or those people are claiming now Sayyidah Zahra wasn't martyred this way. Is it fake or real? Because I will present the point of view, okay? So we continue that they stood in that podium. He claimed Ali ibn Abi Talib, and Omar, he was the second one after Abu Bakr to say, "Bikhim, bikhim, congratulations, Ali, you are now the Mawla of al-Mu'mineen. Yani you are the master of Mu'mineen after Rasulullah." So everyone know that what? That Imam Ali is after Rasulullah, because there was 40,000 Sahaba back then. For the people who went to Hajj with Rasulullah, they know about this. They know about this incident. And there's 12,000 narration inside the books, inside the Sunni books. And we have a book claim all this. Some people, yeah, for sure, they're gonna ask me, what's your proof? Go to Google. It's very easy these days. You don't have to go to a library. Just see the proof of what I'm saying from your own books. It's very easy now these days to check what I'm saying. Okay, so we continue. So why exactly Umar said, do not give him pen and paper? Everyone know that Imam Ali is after Rasulullah. And why he wanna claim that he is crazy? He's getting crazy. You claim someone crazy if he's gonna accuse you of something bad. You did, for example, now if I'm let's say I had a gas station, okay, and someone been working with me. He hit me, he did something to me, he tried to kill me. And then while I'm in the hospital, I'm gonna say, give me something so I can write, he did this to me, so and so. So the other person, what do we will he'll say exactly? Do not give him anything, he's getting delusions.
Discredit.
Yes, discredit. You need to discredit this guy before anything. Because why? Because to protect yourself about an information that nobody knew about it. So that guy, he was planning to take Khilafah after Rasulullah. And he did something to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we have the proof from the Quran. I'm not saying something new. We have the proof. It's in Surah At-Tahrim at the very beginning. Inshallah, later we will reflect more about it. Okay. We'll reflect more in it. Okay. So after that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was martyred. And in the lap of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi. And what happened after that, immediately there was the Thaqifa, where is 11 of the Sahaba Rasulullah, they elected Abu Bakr. And they elected by the sword of Umar, you know, it was peaceful election with the sword. And one of those Sahaba refused to say that Abu Bakr need to be a Khalifa after, because Ali was there. What happened, he was killed, that one of the Sahaba. And in their narration, what they say he was killed by, they said a jinn, a spirit came and killed him while he was walking alone. Next to Saqifa. Look how, who's the delusionist? Yani a guy got killed, and who killed that guy is a jinn. Because he didn't like him, you know, just passing by the jinn, and the jinn find him, did, you know, ugly face and killed him and left. Yeah, that's crazy. But this is inside their books. I didn't say anything from the Shia books till this moment. So 10 people agreed that Abu Bakr need to be Khalifa after Rasulullah. Why? Because if Umar came directly, everyone will be against him. Abu Bakr, he is more older. He was presented as the wise man and so and so and so. And he was able to do something with it, because there's an ayah in the Quran mentioning Abu Bakr with Rasulullah, right? Right, well, while he was inside the cave with Rasulullah. And Rasulullah told him, لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا فَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ سَكِينَتَهُ. And this is getting even more ridiculous, because in the Quran actually it is giving the honor for Rasulullah, and it's something bad for Abu Bakr. Why? Because in the ayahs, Rasulullah, when he told him لا تحزن إن الله معنا, Allah Azza wa Jal, what did he say in the Quran after? Immediately he said وأنزل سكينته عليه, أنزل سكينة الله, يعني the peaceful thing to Rasulullah. He didn't say anzala alayhuma in English for both. He said alayhi only. Some geniuses, they say anzala sakinatahu ala Abu Bakr. He didn't do it for Rasulullah. And in this specifically, if you read all the Quran, anytime Allah Azza wa Jalla, he say anzala, yani he revealed his sakina, he always mentioned the Rasul before the people. This sakina mentioned few times before in the Quran. You know, it is mentioned few times before, and always they say أنزل سكينته على الرسول وعلى المؤمنين. So in this over here, it actually what happened, they bring me this ayah, when immediately they bring me this ayah, I smile. Because this is all what you have. And with this ayah only, you can know the truth. Because if he was true mu'min, Allah Azza wa Jal, he will send his sakina for, he will send it on him too. It will go on him too. So why it didn't go? Because sakina does not go to bad people, it only go to good people, to mu'mineen. I don't want to be more specific. Okay, we continue. So Omar, he want to try to invest this thing from the Quran, because there's many, you know, people who have been living in tents, in desert, they don't have any culture, they don't have anything. They never learned the morality. Rasulullah spent his years trying to teach him morality. Even they used to go outside his tent and they used to call him, Muhammad, Muhammad, hey, come outside, Muhammad. And then what Allah Azza wa Jal, he revealed, he said what? He said, إن الله لا يستحي. And Allah Azza wa Jal, he's not shy. If you come to Rasulullah, أخفض صوتك, your voice, lower it. And talk to him respectfully. He's not your son or someone. Because why? They were so aggressive before. Now after 40, if you wanna know the example, what I'm saying exactly, now visit Saudi Arabia. It's for 1500 years later, right? If you wanna go visit them, they see how they're talking to each other. They're some of them. Now many people are very good people, but some of them they're very savage. The way they talk, the way they treat each other. This is 1500 years after. Imagine what was it during his time. He was dealing basically with animals, the way they treat each other. A guy, he has like maybe 100 women, 100 different slave, they had the money. If you, for example, someone got hungry, he will go hunt someone and kill him and eat him. Exactly like what they're doing now. It's exactly same thing. So Rasulullah, he had to deal with those people. He had to teach him a lot of moralities. So this is one of the things. Anyway, we continue. So while Imam Ali still clean, do ikhtisal, ghusl for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and takfeen, and he put him in the grave, still fresh, didn't even, still crying, all the household of Rasulullah still crying, people still living distressed from what happened. And in the same moment, a couple hours, even in the same, some of them, there's some narration, they say, in the same moment that Imam Ali, he was putting Rasulullah in grave, they already elected Abu Bakr. And many people, they start walking in Medina with sword, saying you have to go do bay'ah for Abu Bakr, or otherwise we'll kill you. This is the democracy they are talking about. And this is mentioned from their books. I'm not saying from the Shia books. This is from their own books. So what happened after Imam Ali, he stood home. And with who? With the Sahaba of Rasulullah, Ammar bin Yasir, Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, and Salman al-Farisi, which we call him Salman al-Muhammadi, and two other Sahaba. And they were talking. They said that Abu Bakr now, with Umar and with all the people who did bay'ah for him, they need you to go to do bay'ah for him, he will be your imam. And Imam refused to do that. He said, everyone know the haq. He said, ya Amir al-Mumin, there are only 11. 10 people, they're doing that, and many people, they're joining with them. Why we can fight them immediately? But Imam Ali refused. Many people, they put question mark there. Why he refused to do that? Even though Imam Ali could go with 100 and kill them all, he doesn't care. You know, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he gave him a lot of strength, a lot of power, and everyone was scared from Imam Ali. Why he didn't do it? Because I always say, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he pick what you guys pick. Okay, what do I mean? For example, if you go to a place that, let's say, I'm not gonna talk about politics, I'm gonna talk, if you live in a community that they have a masjid in a community and they have a sheikh that he's a bad sheikh, okay? And this sheikh been there inside this masjid for 10 years or 15 years, and everyone know he's bad, but nobody change him. It's not because he have power to stay there. No, it's because of you. كما تكونوا يولى عليكم. Whoever you are, Allah Azza wa Jal will send people like you. For example, in Lebanon, Allah Azza wa Jalla sent politicians are very bad. They're good stealers. They steal. Nobody asks them. Everyone happy with them. And every election, you spend five years listening to news. Everyone in the street saying, "I hate that guy. I hate so and so. Those politicians are murderers. Those so and so." And when the election come back, they elect the same people. So after you realize Rasulullah was right, whoever you are, you're gonna bring people like you to govern you. It will go to same thing in Iraq now. Some Iraqis, they always say, "We have so bad politician. They're very bad. They're very munafiqeen." Well, it explains itself. Look who you are. Look what you're doing. Look your way of life. How you're politician. They're gonna come same thing like you. They say they talk about religion. They say we have, let's say, bad maraja. Let's say, okay. Where are the maraja? They're in caves. Where you are? You are in cave too. Because if you are advanced, your maraja gonna be advanced too. Allah Azza wa Jal, He's gonna send same way like you. For example, in Lebanon, we had the marja. He was very open. He was ready to talk to anybody. He had many stations, radios. Why? Because the Lebanese people are like this. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He will send people like you. Same, for example, in Iran. They're very religious people. They want the revolution to continue. Allah Azza wa Jal, He will send them someone to preserve this for them, right? So, see, it is like who you are. Okay. So what happened here, Imam Ali said, if I had 12 people, not 100 or 500, 12 only, one more guy than what they had, I will go and fight them, and I will take the Khilafah back. Why? Because Allah Azza wa Jal there, He found that there is more people need the Haqq more than the people who need the battle. Only He needed maybe seven more people plus those companion of Rasulullah. I mentioned their name before. If He had seven more people, He will get the Khilafah back, and we wouldn't have all the history of bloodshed over the Wilayah and Khilafah till this moment. Only seven people could save all these lives. Imagine. But nobody cared, because they said, "You know what? It's not our business. You know, he died, and then now they're gonna fight who's gonna take the power, and we're gonna follow whoever they more powerful." And this is what happened. So Imam Ali stood there, and I mean, he didn't do anything. He spent all these days collecting Quran, after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he collected all the hadith, all the Quran. He put them all in one book. He spent all his days trying his best to make clarification about many ayat and like explanation or teaching people, whoever come to ask him. But still, Omar, he always want this guy to come and do bay'ah, because he is the only struggle that will continue. And still to this moment, because of that, still, because he knew if Ali ibn Abi Talib went there and he did the bay'ah, everything will be solved. Then whoever Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose him, because he was chosen by God, he did bay'ah for Abu Bakr, then he is 100% legitimate. And nobody can say anything about Abu Bakr anymore, not even us. But Rasulullah, Imam Ali said, "I will always keep helping you, because I'm helping Islam. I'm not helping Abu Bakr or Umar or so. I'm always helping Islam. I'm gonna try my best to use my knowledge Allah Azza wa Jal gave me to spread Islam." And this is a wise thing to do. It was very wise to do. What happened now, few months passed, and still they're not happy with it. You know, Umar always keep talking to Abu Bakr, "You should do something. If that guy that does not come do bay'ah for you, we're gonna lose it. You're gonna lose it. Everyone will say we're gonna follow Imam Ali." Because many people after that, they stop paying their taxes to Abu Bakr, saying, "Why? Because Abu Bakr is not the legitimate Khalifa. We won't pay our taxes except to Ali ibn Abi Talib." And there's a famous incident about Khalid ibn al-Walid. If you ever heard about it, he went. There was a famous incident for Khalid ibn al-Walid, and everybody know it. Even you can open YouTube and listen to it. That he went to a place to collect the taxes, And that guy, he said, I won't pay the tax except to the real Khalifa, and that will be Ali ibn Abi Talib. And that, and Khalid, he said, no, you should pay it for Abu Bakr because he's the real Khalifa. But they start arguing. While they're arguing, and that was a mistake, his wife, the wife of that guy, went outside and start arguing with her husband against Khalid ibn al-Walid. When Khalid ibn al-Walid looked at her, he liked her so much. She was very beautiful. What happened? He chopped his head immediately. He killed him immediately in a spot. Not just that, he boiled his head. He boiled it and he ate it after. And the second day, he committed zina with his wife. And after that, he killed her. When he went back, and this is a famous incident, I'm talking from their books. After when they came, Omar, he refused what he did, because this way, people, they will start revolting against what happened. But Abu Bakr, he said, it's fine. Khalid ibn al-Walid is Saifullah al-Maslul. This is Saifullah al-Maslul. Mazlul, actually, not Maslul. This is Khalid, he was called Saifullah, and the sword of Allah Azza wa Jal. While Amir al-Mu'mineen, he was the Saifullah. Saifullah al-Ghalib. We always say it, right? Ali ibn Abi Talib. He is the real sword of Allah Azza wa Jal, not Khalid ibn al-Walid or any guy. And subhanAllah, Allah Azza wa Jal, after all what he did, Khalid ibn al-Walid, after all his battle, and so maybe more than 1,000 battle all his life, he did it for Islam, okay? He never died as a martyr, subhanAllah, he died on his bed. Allah Azza wa Jal, he didn't give him to die as a martyr, because you know that guy, he was munafiq. And the proof what I said is claiming, yani what I am claiming is, and anyway, we continue. So many people, they start revolting against Abu Bakr because they want Ali ibn Abi Talib. And if Ali ibn Abi Talib do the bay'ah for Abu Bakr, everyone will be, yani this one, the Khilafah will be peaceful now. Abu Bakr does not want anyone to go against him. So there is more voices saying to Abu Bakr, you should go push Ali ibn Abi Talib to do bay'ah for you. What happened is, that time, he got like an army, his army, and he said, we should go take Ali ibn Abi Talib from inside the house and make him come to the masjid to bay'ah for Abu Bakr by force. He should do it by force, or other way we'll kill him with his family. So what happened, in all the narration, Shia narration, they said they sent an army with Umar. But the reality is, they sent an army, and Umar was with them, and Abu Bakr was with them too, not just Umar. And what happened, they went to the house, and they made sure like nobody can run from the house. Surround. They surrounded all the house. Yeah, they surrounded it from all direction, and they got heavy army, not just few people, maybe 40 or maybe 60 or 70 people surrounding all the house. And they start yelling that Ali should come out from outside the house because the door was closed. And Imam Ali, he knew that those people are outside, okay, and they're surrounding the house. They didn't come as police force now, you know, they use the force, they open the door immediately, they come take you from outside and take you, no. Because they couldn't do that, because they know who's Ali, but everyone was scared. So they said, we should surround the house and we start doing the negotiation. This is how we started it. So they start doing the negotiation. Now I'm talking logic, okay? I'm gonna present the other way. Some people claim that this didn't happen, and we will see what exactly happened from logic point of view. So they start doing the negotiation. Imam Ali refused to go outside. Till this point, everyone agreed on Sunnis and Shia. Till this point, okay. After that, what happened? Maybe a few hours they spent outside. They fed up, they said we should bring Imam Ali to the masjid by force. And they start screaming from outside. Imam Ali still refused. And now Omar, he said, bring Ali from inside. And one of them, he said, لكن فاطمة في الدار, سيدة فاطمة الزهراء is inside the house. Why he said that? He said that because everyone know that Fatima al-Zahra is bid'at Rasulullah, because always Rasulullah, when he used to come to the house, his house, Because basically Hujrat Fatima, I mean the house of Fatima the Zahra, was next to the Prophet's house. When he exited his house, immediately he go to her door and he stood there in the door and he will always say Assalamu alaikum ahla bayt al-nubuwa wa mawdi' al-risala wa mukhtalif al-malaika, and then he leave. And then when he come back, he stood in the door and he said Assalamu alaikum ya ahla bayt al-nubuwa for 6 months before his death. Rasulullah, he always used to that in the door of Fatima. So that person, he know that Rasulullah, he always used to stand in that door. So that's why he said Fatima is inside. So everybody know who was Fatima. It was so huge, it's a huge thing that in the same door that Rasulullah used to stand, they're gonna break it and Fatima Zahra is gonna be behind it. But why this has happened? Now we will go more logical. Till this moment, till this, what happened now, Umar, what he said, wa in yakun, so he said, so like wa in yakun, even if Fatima, well, who cares? This is what he said. Till this moment in a hadith, Sunnis and Shias are exactly the same. After that, they change. Some of them, they say, after Umar, he said, so just break the door and take Ali ibn Abi Talib, and they continue the argument by saying, okay, if you are inside your house. Now, this is how they approach that subject. If you are inside your house and you have a wife, and you know the police is outside standing, would you send your wife to open the door? Why? Because it's bad for us, and for in our culture, you should be the man, right? You should have the sword and go outside. Why you wanna put your wife in the front? Okay, if you hear this at the very first time or later, you'll start be convinced. It's logical. Right, we especially Ali ibn Abi Talib is the man of karam and akhlaq, morality, and he protected Fatima many times. And why he wanna put her in a front line where they gonna come and they might kill her, they might do so and so to her? It is very logical, right? You for the first time, it is, you feel very logical. But if you say it is logical, then you didn't understand who is Ali, you didn't understand who is Fatima. Let me tell you how. In the way to Allah Azza wa Jal, in the way of going toward Allah Azza wa Jal, you always put yourself in the front. In the meaning. Okay. How? Let's say now there's a leader here, regular religious leader. Okay. Let's say the Sheikh of the Masjid here, he was doing a revolution in some place, some area, and he was standing. He is inside your house. A police guys, they're outside your house, and they wanna come and take him, kill him immediately. What you would do? You will put him in the front there, or we will preserve him, right? You will preserve him for sure, and you put your life in front, right? Okay. Who was the Imam of that time? Imam Ali. Imam Ali was the Imam of that time. Okay. If any person from inside the house, even though there was five Sahaba with Imam Ali, and there was five women, maybe few women with Sayyida Zahra, any guy from those people, he will leave the where he was sitting, and he will go stand at that door other than Fatima al-Zahra, he will be better than Fatima al-Zahra. You know what I mean? For example, now Imam Mahdi has come, and he's sitting inside the house where there is 7 or 8 people there, right? And people, they, let's say someone outside, he's standing, and he wanna come kill, yani God forbid, Imam Sahib al-Asr al-Zaman, what you would do? Exactly. Some people, they gonna immediately go up, stand up. Some of them, they gonna run immediately to that person, to this table, right? And some people, they might run because they saw someone with a knife or with a gun to kill. So some of them, they wanna run. Some of them, they wanna stand. And some of them, they wanna go in the other direct, what, to protect Imam Sahib al-Aswazan. So what, which one will be the best? The one will be the best who immediately reflected to go and disable that guy, right? He will be the best from those people sitting. So Sayyida Zahra, she is indirectly teaching us a great lesson. The first lesson is, even if she's a woman, she has to protect her Imam of her Zaman. She has, because her blood is nothing with blood. The value of her blood is nothing regarding the blood of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. Even if she is Sayyida Zahra, bid'at Rasulullah. You see? Are you getting the picture now? Okay. Any guy, even if, for example, Salman al-Faris or Abu Dhar al-Ghafari or whatever you want to call, he will go directly to the door, he will be better than Sayyida Zahra alayhi salam. And Allah Azza wa Jal, He does not accept that. Why women, they come to us, they say, we are equal. Why do they want to make it equal now? Why always women has to be hiding? It's not, she wasn't hiding. What happened is that guy, when Umar, he said, وَإِنْ يَكُنْ, she heard him, everyone in the house heard him, because Umar, what he was playing, a psychological war. That guy, he said, he's screaming, وَفَاطِمَ فِي الدَّارِ, and everyone inside that room, because they didn't have a mansion. You know, Sayyida Zahra, she wasn't, and Ali ibn Abi Talib, they weren't living in a mansion. They were living in a small house that have two rooms only, with a bathroom in the middle, that's it. Two small room. It was like rectangle, and then two cubes inside, and then there was a restroom in the middle over there in a corner. That's it. This is that all her house. So anyone passed by, even he was talking normal voice, everyone inside the house will hear what they're talking. So what happened, Umar, when he said wa in yakun, he screamed it. He screamed wa in yakun, because he's saying basically I don't care. So Sayyida Zahra, she heard that. And when they start hitting the door to open it, what she said, she did, she said, I am the first one after Rasulullah who gonna be martyred for the sake of wilaya. They always say the first woman who was martyred, she was the wife of Al-Mukhtar al-Thaqafi, the one who fought for Imam Hussein after. He was revenging for Imam Hussein. His wife was the first shahida in Islam. She was the first martyr. Al-Zubayr killed her because she was defending her husband. Actually, she wasn't the first. The first woman and the first one ever killed after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and martyred was Sayyida Zahra alayhi sallam. Why? Because with her blood, with her body, she immediately went to the door and she stood there. Because why? Because now she is protecting the wilaya. Of who? Of her imam of her zaman. Imam zaman for her. And by doing that, she proved that she's the best person in that place after Amir al-Mu'mineen. And Imam Ali could tell her, no, don't do that. No, he couldn't, because they were sitting in one room and they were sitting in another room. And when Sayyida Zahra heard Umar saying وَإِنْ يَكُنْ, and that guy, he started breaking the door with his legs. Few people, they breaking the door with their legs very strongly, very firmly. Immediately she went to the door. She does not want him to take the imam of her. Not, she didn't care about a husband. She cared about the imam. Okay, now if you are, do it for yourself. Take this example. Imam Sahib al-Asr al-Zaman, he's sitting here now, let's say. And people outside, they're trying to take him from here. And you heard her saying, so let's go inside. What do you want to do? You have two options, or three options. Either stay, okay, either run, or either what? Go to the door directly. And the person who will go to the door directly, he will be the highest of those people. And we know the story of Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein, when he left the Hajj, he didn't leave with 70 people. He left with 45,000. When Karbala, you always take Karbala like from the very end. Nobody really studied Karbala from the very beginning. What happened is there were 45,000 with Imam Hussein. They're all going against Yazid. Every station, Imam Hussein will go up. He say, everyone, I don't want to take you with me. If you want, you can go. You're all always welcome. But if you have people, if you have, for example, sons to take care of, if you have businesses and so, you can do them and then come back. Many people will find this is a chance to run away. So and so, till they reach Karbala with 70 people only. The land of Karbala. Same thing with Sayyida Zahra, with Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. It was exactly the same thing. Only the people who were standing inside the house of Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra of Imam Ali, they were the last people. Only four Sahaba or five Sahaba from the man and a few Sahaba from the woman. And that's it. Because all were filtered. Nobody stood there except Sayyida Zahra to show that nobody ever, because we have many narration, even from the Sunnis, saying how much Sayyida Zahra, she was valuable to Rasulullah. And Allah Azza wa Jal, through Rasulullah, he said, Allah يغضب لغضب فاطمة ويرضى لرضا. يعني Allah Azza wa Jal, he will be very angry if Sayyida Zahra got angry on someone. And he will be happy and content in a person that Sayyida Zahra content and happy with, to that point. So she put all this value to protect the wilayah, which is more seems more logical now. See, a guy who is following culture, he told his wife to go inside because he want to stand for that. Or a woman that she's teaching Muslims, because she said to Zahra that she should, even with her body, with her soul, even if she's the best woman Allah Azza wa Jal created, and he create everything from her womb, that she is there standing to defend the way of Allah Azza wa Jal. Why? Because I told you before, Imams, they use each other for Ridha Allah Azza wa Jal. They use each other for the content of Allah Azza wa Jal. While we don't do that. Imam Ali always say, أردتموني لأنفسكم, you want me for yourselves. But all of you, I want you for Allah Azza wa Jal. For example, when we go to visit his grave, we just want our needs to تحقق الحوائج. يعني for example, I want $1,000,000, so I'll go to Imam Ali. Please, Imam Ali, I ask you to ask Allah Azza wa Jal to give me $1,000,000. Imam Ali, he will ask Allah Azza wa Jal because he want you to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. But we treat Imam Ali how? We treat as a person that for ourselves, not as a person that Allah Azza wa Jal chose for us to be closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. When I love Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, I love him because Allah Azza wa Jal told me to love him. Not because he's cute and he has a long hair, and because he's powerful and he has the biggest sword, and because so and so. Not because of that. For example, when you go to Mecca, many people, they always tell me, why you visit stones? Our Imam, they say stones, you know. You worship the graves. I immediately tell them, why you visit Mecca? Mecca is just a stone too. You go there and you start turning next to the stones, right? So why we do that? Because Allah Azza wa Jal chose those stones to be turned by. We do the revolving around those stones. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he chose them to do that. If he didn't choose them, we wouldn't do it. You can do it around your house and you be a hajj. What's the difference between these stones inside your around your house and the stones of Mecca? Nothing. There's no holy stones in Islam. Okay, so why you go to Mecca and you cry next to the Kaaba? And that guy will be shot. Because Allah Azza wa Jal, he chose them. He told you to go to that area and perform pilgrimage. And when we go to our imams, we're not visiting stones. We're not worshipping the graves. We are going there to get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that's why, for the same reason, Sayyida Zahra, because she went, sent a letter through time that I was killed, I was martyred. And for this reason, I don't want anybody to visit my grave from those munafiqeen. That's why her grave is still secret till this moment. Nobody knows where his grave except the mu'mineen. Only mu'mineen know the grave, because Allah Azza wa Jal is not gonna make you suffer so much to know where Sayyida Zahra is. But for those munafiqeen, he will make them suffer. Because after, with Imam Hussein, what happened? The same people who killed Imam Hussein, later they come and they start saying, you know, Yazid told us to kill Imam Hussein. And Yazid, he said, no, I didn't order them to kill Imam Hussein. Those people killed Imam Hussein. Shimr killed Imam. And Shimr say, no, I didn't kill Imam Hussein. That guy told me to do so and so. So nobody know who killed Imam Hussein at the end. Even though it's a system that killed Imam Hussein. That killing started with what? With Sayyida Zahra alayhi salam. She died. She was martyred very quietly. Until this moment, her Shia still make her suffer more and more and more by saying what? No, she wasn't killed. Why she wanna be killed? Imam Ali was inside. Imam Ali was inside. He could go and open the door and everything will be fine. But instead of teaching us who is Sayyida Zahra, now we are losing the way more and more. We are fading. Why? Because I told you before, We are only focusing in aqa'id. We're not focusing anymore in ruhaniyat, in spiritualities. We're not focusing anymore in the Quran. I worked in a library for almost 9 months. 9 months in library, big library. Almost every single day, maybe 15 or 16 people used to come. I was always ready for someone to come and ask me what's the best book for me to get more knowledgeable. But only every single day, people only come ask me for fatawa. Fatawa. Always. At the end, I was like a robot. If someone come inside the library, I'll go out there, bring him fatawa and go take it and leave. Yeah, the most printing books now as fatawa books, they're not knowledge books, they're not spiritualities, they're not. Why? Because we're getting like robots now. We're not anymore. We comprehend religion as just fasting, praying, but we don't really know why we're fasting. We don't really know why we're praying. I'm not disclaiming that this shouldn't be happening. That's good. But, you know, these ones are things that you're always going to keep learning. But what if you always keep following just the fatawa and you leave the spirituality? Now, for example, inshallah, when you go to Hajj, inshallah, when you go to Hajj, you will see all the spiritual leaders. They should be spiritual leaders, they call them, Sheikh. They go, and for example, when you stand on the next stone, you stone the devil. There's no devil there. It's a symbol. They tell you, take 7 stones and make sure the stones, they hit the middle. If you hit the corner, if you hit it down, or if you hit it up, you have to repeat it back. You should make 100% sure that it hit the middle. And you go find many people, they're just standing there and they're being like bull eyes, you know, pew, pew, pew. And if they didn't do it, they hire someone. And how they hire it? They say, Wakkaltuka, I gave you the permission from my side, Muhammad ibn Mish'arif Min, and later maybe you will give him the ID number, because Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't know, you know. You should give him all this tawkeel, and that guy, he should say, قَبِلْتُ التَّوْكِيلَ الْمُوَقَّعَ عَدْنَا, and I'm so happy that you give me the tawkeel, and you will be cleared amam Allah Azza wa Jal. It's like half hour declaration. Like, it's like Allah Azza wa Jal does not know. And then you go there, you start stoning, and you feel so proud, because you're stoning it so hard, and it's hitting the middle. And after that, you finish, and then nothing from the spirituality happened. While you are hitting the symbol devil, while you are hitting this, you should remember all your dhunub. You should your the bad deeds that you did. It's not, I don't really care if you hit the middle or end or up. It's a symbol. But many people, they're focusing for that symbol. They forget why is it there. You see, all the Hajj people, they follow only instruction. They don't really follow why they're doing that. While they're in Arafah, they want to sleep because tomorrow it's a long day. While you are there, you should be worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. It's the only chance that Allah Azza wa Jal is. Al-Hajj, all pilgrim, is Arafah. You go there, you find people fighting over whose air-conditioned tent they have, or what's the best shower in every tent they have, or when you are inside, what you should, you know, there's many technicalities. They're not important. They're not important at all. If you go to ever Arafah, do not go inside your tent that have an air conditioner. Go outside, go and sleep in the dust. Make yourself bleed. Really, really, if you can make yourself bleed, make it. Yeah, go to the spiritual universe in Hajj, not to the physical, that you should be happy, content, that you took a place while all the elderly people are still left. You see how many poor people, if you go to Medina, there are only a block that is, if you go there, you think you live in Europe. But if you exit that block, you see people are walking without shoes. And the blood is coming out from their. Just try, go from outside the box that they put you in. This is the real spirituality. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Sayyida Zahra want you to know. It's not always what you see. It's not the mainstream. Always there's a way for Allah Azza wa Jal. And what is this way is the hardest. A guy came to Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said, "Ana muhibbun lakum." I hope I am from your Shia. I became a lover for Ahlul Bayt. He said, if you did so, prepare for poverty. This is what he told me. He didn't tell him prepare for good thing gonna happen to you. He said prepare for poverty and prepare for miserable things gonna happen to you. And many things bad gonna happen always, and ibtilaat and so from inside and outside. And why? Because this is the way of Allah Azza wa Jal. The more harder it is, the more you're gonna reach. So what's the hardest thing is to think about what happened to Sayyida Zahra is this way. She stood there in a door and that guy broke the door, and she was this wood entered her tummy, and there was a in her womb the brother of Hassan and Hussein. His name Al-Muhsin, and look at his name. Imam Ali, he called him Al-Muhsin. Why? Because he is Muhsin. Muhsin means a person, he give you something that you didn't ask for. When you, for example, you go to a place and you someone comes to you and he give you water and he leaves, oh, you say him, this is Muhsin in Arabic.
Hassan.
Yeah, Muhsin. Yeah, you know, someone, he gave you something you didn't ask for. So Al-Muhsin, that guy, that kid was his name. So just try to reflect why he's named him Al-Muhsin. If you really reach that point, you will know what he will give you later on. Because all the secrets are in that door. All the secrets in that door. And then they come inside while everyone stood up. And Imam Ali even, he put his hand in the sword because he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered me to be patient for what's gonna happen after, but he didn't say be patient for what's gonna happen to Sayyida Zahra. So everyone was scared. Everyone was scared. Nobody touched him. And what happened is Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said to Abu Dharr al-Ghafari and to Salman al-Farisi, don't do anything. While everyone was crying hard. It was a painful thing for what happened to Sayyida Zahra. It's very painful. Really imagine what happened to that lady. Yani, if you imagine your mom, what happened to her, this woman, she's your real mom, Sayyida Zahra. She's the real mom of Mu'mineen. What happened to her in that moment? While Imam Ali, he ordered nothing happened, but Abu Dharr al-Ghafari, he used to always walk. He used to always walk with a wood stick with his head. So he started hitting them in the head till they exited the door. But Imam Ali, he ordered him back to don't do it anymore. So he stopped. And Amir al-Mu'mineen, he said, Abu Bakr and Umar, they said, you should come to the masjid to do the bay'ah for him to prevent what's going to happen after bloodshed more inside the house. He said, I'll go with you to the masjid. So when he went to the masjid, he refused to do the bay'ah, and he presented a big lecture that everyone, he said, we shouldn't anymore come to Ali ibn Abi Talib. In that moment, Sayyida Zahra, what happened to her, all the blood outside, few days, she ordered her servant to bring her kafan. And she said, nobody will wash me because I did wash myself. That she was the only person that nobody washed her, and she was the first person ever to be put in a tabut, what we call tabut. Why? Because she cannot be in a grave inside the arud, because nobody will know what's gonna happen after that till Imam Mahdi comes and he will reveal what exactly her location is for everyone. Because a person visit the grave of Sayyida Zahra, Allah Azza wa Jal, he will 100% take him to heaven, even if he was Yazid. But for this reason, Sayyida Zahra, she kept it secret. Only 6 people that moment, that time, know who they are. For sure, the Sahaba of Rasulullah, Ammar and Abu Dharr and Salman Muhammadi and Al-Hasan Al-Husayn wa Ali ibn Abi Talib, they took her grave, they buried it in a place next close to Al-Medina. And nobody know exactly where is it except the people who are very close to Ahlul Bayt, and they will reveal this secret to them. Any question?
Why did she have to be in a coffin?
Yeah, she has to, because she will not be buried inside the coffin, because it's a movable thing. It's a like.
So they placed her one place and then they relocated her?
No, no, she's always in one place, but they cannot put her, yani they cannot get her inside the grave, because later she will be moved by Imam Sahib al Asr wa Zaman.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, there's a hadith.
Abu Bakr was telling that Umar was very aggressive, yeah, against Fatima. Abu Bakr was like, that's Fatima bint Muhammad, and told so what? She's
so what?
A woman.
Yes.
So at that situation, was it Abu Bakr?
I heard the story that there's a servant, yani there's a soldier that he said that. But Abu Bakr, he was there.
And then after they didn't they set fire to the house?
Yeah, they did, for in a door. They start the fire, but they start immediately breaking the door, because they know.
Before they broke down the door. Khalid ibn Walid, Rasulullah, when he first entered Mecca, did he send him somewhere? He did something bad too.
Yeah, that was I said. That's what this is, the story that I was telling you. Yeah, this is after Rasulullah. Yeah, after Rasulullah, this one. I haven't heard that story. Maybe it happened, but I haven't heard of it. Yalla, wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ahli bayti at-tayyibin at-tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.